Random House Audio presents Don't Know Much About Mythology. Everything you need to know about the greatest stories in human history but never learned. By Kenneth C. Davis. Read for you by John Lee and Lorna Raver. Throughout the inhabited world, in all times and under every circumstance, the myths of man have flourished, and they have been the living inspiration of whatever else may have appeared out of the activities of the human body and mind. Joseph Campbell, The Hero with a Thousand Faces.
Hi, this is Ken Davis. In the olden days, that seems like a good opening for a book about myths. When I was about 11 years old, I could not sit still at my fifth grade desk. I squirmed, I fidgeted, my mind wandered. Oh, I tried, but I didn't remember much of anything I was supposed to learn, except that at the end of each day, as the clock on the wall ticked slowly toward 3 o'clock and freedom, I would sit like a stone in anticipation of those few minutes before dismissal when our teacher set aside the math and science to read aloud from The Odyssey. Magically connected over the vastness of centuries to the people who heard these tales once sung around campfires, I was captivated. Instead of fighting fractions and verbs, I was aboard a ship, sailing mythical oceans, battling witches, demons, and one-eyed monsters, trying to find my way home with brave Odysseus, the wily hero of Homer's epic. Those daily doses of this great Greek story made my day, gave me a taste for literature and poetry, and certainly whetted my appetite for more mythology. Myths continue to fascinate me, and millions of others. Only most of us don't call it mythology. We like to call it going to the movies. For instance, on a cold Vermont night a few years ago, I went to see the second installment in the Lord of the Rings trilogy with my two teenagers and another friend. We were lucky to get tickets as they sold out quickly. As we took our seats, people were scrambling futilely to find places, and I envisioned one of my worst personal fears, a raucous crowd of kids on Christmas break talking throughout the show. But as soon as the lights went down, the extraordinary occurred. There was complete silence in this small Rutland theater. When the nearly three-hour-long movie was over, the silence continued for a moment, and then the crowd exploded with loud and sustained applause. Merits of the film aside, I was struck at how reverent the audience was. Chances are, a good many people in that audience were not churchgoers, and sitting in this darkened theater may have been as close to some form of collective spiritual encounter as they might ever have come. And I thought further that this experience probably connected this 21st century collection of strangers back to something much deeper, the act of sitting around a campfire 3,000 years ago as someone recounted timeless exploits of heroes and monsters, good versus evil. Looking at some of the box office hits of the past few years merely confirms this idea. Recently, theaters have been filled with hits like The Matrix, Finding Nemo, X-Men, and the Terminator trilogy. To a large degree, all of these Hollywood blockbusters tap into ancient myths and tales of legendary heroes and epic quests. And it's not just entertainment. Do you like Halloween and its Hispanic equivalent, Dia de los Muertos, or Day of the Dead? Both are modern vestiges of ancient mythical celebrations. Or perhaps you celebrate Christmas and Easter. With its candles and gift-giving, Christmas is based on old pagan Roman holidays, including the Saturnalia, a week-long festival of the winter solstice dedicated to the god of agriculture. The Easter celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is closely associated with pagan festivals celebrating the coming of spring. Myths also play a serious role in history. Perhaps the most deadly historical example of the impact of myth comes from World War II, when Adolf Hitler drew upon ancient Germanic myths to help enthrall an entire country. Hitler was deeply taken by Wagner's operas, which drew vividly on the world of Germanic heroic myths, pagan gods and heroes, demons and dragons. Hitler intrinsically understood the deep emotional power of the symbols of these myths. Massive statues of ancient Germanic gods played a prominent role in the Nazi mass rallies at Nuremberg in the 1930s. Hitler grasped the visceral power as well as the propaganda value of a shared Teutonic myth in uniting the German people with a master race ideology. So, myths can be a powerful business, and that is one reason they have been around for thousands of years. As old as humanity, the first myths belong to a time when the world was full of danger, mystery, and wonder. In the earliest of human times, every society developed its own myths, which eventually played an important part in the society's daily life and religious rituals. One of the chief reasons that myths came into being was because people couldn't provide scientific explanations for the world around them. Natural events, as well as human behavior, all came to be understood through tales of gods, goddesses, and heroes. Thunder, earthquakes, eclipses, the seasons, rain, and the success of crops were all due to the intervention of powerful gods. Obviously, we now have many more scientific answers for most of our questions about the world and universe. We know why the sun rises and sets, why the rain falls in some seasons and not in others, what makes crops grow. We have a much better understanding of where we came from. We understand illness and death to a certain degree. And although the source of evil in the world and why bad things happen to good people is still a great mystery, we have even begun to unravel the beginnings of the universe. But in earlier times, people invented stories to explain these beginnings. In the creation story of the Krachi people of Togo in Africa, for instance, the creator god Wulbari and man lived close together, and Wulbari lay on top of Mother Earth. But there was so little space to move about that the smoke of the cooking fires got in Wulbari's eyes and annoyed the god. In disgust, Wulbari went away and rose up to the present place where humans can admire him but not reach him. For more than 100 years, scholars have debated different views of the role that myths have played in the human experience. In his 1949 classic, The Hero with 1,000 Faces, Joseph Campbell wrote, "Religions, philosophies, arts, the social forms of primitive and historic man, prime discoveries in science and technology, the very dreams that blister sleep, boil up from the basic magic ring of myth." Exploring Campbell's magic ring of myth takes Don't Know Much About Mythology into territory that has been touched upon in my previous books, especially those about the Bible and the universe, the powerful connections between belief and science, the conflicts between faith and the rational world, and a deeper sense of the mysterious in human life, which are all part of man's search for meaning. I remember so well how myths saved one little boy from that tedium. And I also believe that the story of myth is ultimately about our innate human curiosity. Across centuries of time and great distances of culture, mythology is about that common human experience and that driving curiosity about other people, the world, the heavens. Deeper than intellect alone, it's a piece of what makes us what we are. Call it soul, collective unconscious, or even superstition. I hope, if nothing else, this book will help you discover that childlike curiosity that has driven us from the dark caves to the outermost edges of the universe.
Chapter 1. All men have need of the gods. Badness you can get easily, in quantity. The road is smooth and it lies close by. But in front of excellence, the immortal gods have put sweat, and long and steep is the way to it, and rough at first. But when you come to the top, then it is easy, even though it is hard. Hesiod, about 700 BCE, the Theogony. What are myths? When people use the word myth today, they often have in mind something that is widely believed but untrue, like alligators in the sewers of New York City, which is really not a myth at all, but an urban legend. In another sense, it is now common to talk about the myth of the cowboys of the old American West, and there are plenty of other so-called myths in American history. Old ones that die hard, and new ones being created all the time. Myths about the Founding Fathers, the Civil War, slavery, the 60s. Just about any period or movement in America's past has been mythologized and layered with legend to some degree. In the ancient world, myth had a meaning that is almost completely opposite to our modern concept of myth as an untruth. In the earliest days of humanity, myths existed to convey essential truths. They were, in a very real sense, what many people today might call gospel. The word myth is derived from the Greek word mythos, for story. And when the Greek...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.